Hello my friends, welcome again to my video channel. Today we will continue our work on the Braun SE402. I wanted to check the red function now, but another problem came up. In the last sequence I heard a hum in the transceiver coming from the transformer. I thought it was coming from the transformer mechanical vibration, because my own SE400 has the same problem. Sometimes such transformers are not so good mechanically. I tried, I measured all voltages, of course. Supply voltages, they were all okay. The internal voltages, they were stabilized as it should be. According to the data sheet, no problem. Today I also wanted to focus on the hum. I made a measurement with my scope. I saw a little bit, a big ripple on the filter caps in the power supply. So I thought, okay, create a load, connected a dummy load, switched on the FM transmitter, increased the power to 10 watt, and suddenly a fuse was blown. The fuse is the fuse for the rectifier. This is an ugly thing, because the rectifier is not so, cannot be accessed very easy. It is on this PCB, but to get this PCB out, I have a new one with better values. That's not a problem. I measured it. The transformer is okay. Unsoldered here this pin. I tried to unsolder this wire from the transformer and the pin came out. That's what I feared. It's not so good to such a pin here. It is soldered only on the lower side. But now the transformer has no load and the transformer is okay. I also supplied the transceiver with DC via the DC input, 13 volt. It works, no problem. So I'm quite sure the problem is inside here. This is the rectifier. Maybe the hum was caused by the rectifier, that there's a short. This would cause also a little bit, a big ripple here on these filter caps. The capacity of the filter caps, I measured them, 4,700 microfarads, according to the data sheet. Two times I've measured a little bit more than 8 millifarads with my capacitance meter. That's okay, no problem. The ripple cannot be caused by them. So I assume that this rectifier has a problem. Maybe an internal short or one of the diodes is faulty. Anyhow, I have to repair it. To get access to the lower side, to the bottom side of this PCB, it's rather easy. Unsolder these wires, four wires, and then I can flip out this board. Be careful not to break anything here on this side, especially the antenna connector, which is here, could break, and also these coax cables, which are the high frequency cables. We should be careful here, but in general we can take it out. But before I take it out completely, I want to show you something regarding testing this rectifier, whether it is okay or not. For this purpose, I will use my component tester in my scope. It's a nice feature this scope has, and I can show you how it is possible to check such components. This component tester is a rather simple feature. This is the voltage, and in the vertical we have the current. When I produce a short circuit, current, no voltage, voltage, no current. The voltage here is approximately 7 volt RMS, that means 10 volt peak or so, and the vertical current, short circuit current, is also in the range of 6 or 7 milliamps. That's 10 milliamp peak. So a resistance of 1 kilo ohm would generate a horizontal line. We don't do it. But with this, it's possible to check, for example, a rectifier. This is AC, of course, AC driven with 50 Hertz from the transformer internally. And this can used be as a simple checker. Diodes can be seen. We will see it in the next sequence when I connect it to the faulty rectifier. Just to show what I'm doing, I'm connecting the component tester here to this two pins where the AC comes in from the power transformer. One side is open from the power transformer, so we have here an open input, and the two electrolytics are still present, but this fuse is also open, so we measure only this rectifier and two capacitors, the filter caps, nothing more. The clips are connected to the input of the rectifier. One pin is in, here I have the other pin. I connect it to the component tester. And here we see the diodes. We see one side is creeping up very, very slowly. That means the capacitor is charged. But the other direction here, this negative voltage is still shorted at a very low voltage. We have approximately 1 volt per division, or a little bit less. 2 volt. 2, 4, 6. 2 volt. It is 10 volt. 2 volt per division. So we have a little bit less than 1 volt. We see the capacitor, or the two capacitors, are charged up, but the other half of the bridge rectifier is still shorted, and this causes a fuse to trip, to be blown. And this one is creeping up slowly, very slowly, because the milliamps we have here only take some time to charge up a high capacitive capacitor. So I think it will take some minutes until it is fully charged, and after some minutes it will disappear here on this side. And now after some minutes we see the capacitor is nearly fully charged. It takes some more time. I don't wait for it. I only wanted to show how it is connected to the bridge rectifier. We can see here the two clips which are connected. Now I will take out this rectifier. It is faulty, as we have seen, and replace it by a new one. I have a new one which has 125 volt, not only 40 volt as the old one had. It's for 5 amps, 5000 milliamps capacitive load. Well, the other one was also for 5000 milliamps capacitive load, but has a higher voltage rating. I think it's better to have a higher rating, and it's a more modern one, smaller case. I will replace it, and then we will see what happens. To get this rectifier out, I pinched off the leads, the pins, and I could take them out pin by pin. It's easier for me. Now I will take some solder braid to remove the old solder, and then I can insert a new one. Before I do this, of course, we have to check the pin layout, but it is identical, minus AC, AC plus, minus AC, AC plus, and there's a space between plus and AC. That's okay. It will fit into the old holes. Then I will start to take out the solder. And I use also some flux to do it. It's much easier, because this solder braid is sometimes rather dry and there's not so much flux in it as it should. The new rectifier is in place now. Be careful not to damage the wires, the traces. They are a little bit weak. The quality isn't the best. I keep some distance between the rectifier and the PCB surface. In my SE400, this rectifier gets a little bit hot, so I think it's a good idea to have some millimeter distance, so the rectifier is a little bit higher than it could be. Shouldn't sit flat on the top, on the top of the top side. And now I can solder it. And before I reinstall everything, I will again connect my CT component tester. CT stands not for curve tracer. It's a very simple curve tracer. It's simply a component tester. Connected it, and then we will have a look at the scope again. And now same procedure as before. Second wire, I connect it to the component tester. And now we see both sides are drifting to the charged voltage of the electrolytic caps. So we don't have the short as we had before. It will also take some or several minutes until it is charged up, we don't wait for it. But now we see we have no problems. And the rectifier now is okay. Then take away the residues, the flux, with some isopropyl alcohol or any similar. And wipe over the connections, the solder connections, to get it out. I also resoldered the pin from the power transformer, which came out. Take the other side and do the job as long as necessary. And then make an optical inspection whether the solder joints are okay and whether there are any shorts which shouldn't be there. There's sometimes a danger that there are shorts. Use such a small mirror to have a look at it. Now it looks rather good. A little bit residue of the flux I have to remove, but in general it's okay now. Just for curiosity, what do we see here? I again connected the component tester to the AC connections of the rectifier. You remember we had this curve with the two diodes charging up the capacitor. Now we have here such a pattern. What is this? Well, this is the inductivity of the secondary side of the power transformer. This has a very low impedance. We see we get nearly no voltage drop, only current, and the circle or ellipsoid is an indication that we have an inductivity. So I cannot measure such a rectifier when the power transformer is connected parallel, because the low impedance of the power transformer is very much lower than the impedance of the rectifier. The power supply board is in place again. All connections are soldered. Nothing is broken here. I checked it. It's all okay. Careful. Here we have 230 volt AC. It's a nice voltage. I know what I'm talking about. The most important thing. What do you hear? Nothing. The hum is gone. Absolutely quiet. Even when I increase the gain, SSB, I can do it also in FM. When I use the squelch with full AF gain, nothing, absolutely nothing. Okay, when I have noise, but no hum, absolutely no hum. So I assume that this rectifier, the old one, was damaged. It was pre-damaged. There was a small damage. Maybe one of the four diodes was conductive a little bit in the reverse direction. So it still worked as a rectifier, but the transformer was shorted on the secondary side by this defective diode. One half wave, of course, only one half wave, as we have seen in the component tester on the screen. So I'm quite sure that this was the reason for the hum, which is now gone and solved. So we have a good progress now. It was a longer work to get it done, but I think it was worth to do it. And luckily this rectifier died when the transceiver was on my workbench. It would be a pity when I send it back to the owner and then it dies. That's what I don't like. So it's good that it happened here. Well, this problem is solved now with the hum. So I can focus finally on the RID. And now to the RID topic, the problem of the RID. There's a RID knob, standard, switch for the RID. And when the RID is centered, it is mechanically centered, the knob is okay as it should. Left, right, to the center. But when we switch on the RID in the center position, the frequency shifts a little bit. There is a pot to align the center of the RID. This is the third pot here on this PCB. But the pot is on its left position and cannot be adjusted correctly to have a centered RID. The owner told me he was not able to align this pot, this trim pot. I tried it also. I was also not able to do this. So there is a, maybe there's a fault or any other problem. So let's have a look at the RID circuit and what the problem is. So let's have first a look at the RID circuit. We can see here the VCO, which is a part of the frequency generation. It has an oscillator, 64.65 megahertz, Kreisel oscillator. It is doubled to 129.3 megahertz, where the 5 megahertz PTO, or sorry, a VCO, and the other frequencies, the 10.7 megahertz, is mixed. And there is an input called RID. It's pin A. Without RID, there is a voltage of 3.85 volt. It's generated from the 8.5 volt here. And when we calculate this voltage divider, 47k, 39k, we have here, theoretically, without any errors, 3.85 volt. I will measure it. First, I will measure the internal 8.5 volt. I hope you can read it. These internal 8.5 volts, I can measure it here. Oh, it's the input, 17 volt, but not good. 8.575. And then I go to the, it's a little bit more than 8.5. Then we can expect here a little bit more. I go to this input. I measure 3.90 volt instead of calculated 3.85 volt. Okay, acceptable. No problem, obviously, up to now. But the problem is on the RID side here. It's a little bit difficult to see, but the RID pot from the front is here, 500 ohms. And the RID pot here is also supplied via pin E, which is E, with 8.5 volt. But these 8.5 volt are not the same 8.5 volt we have seen before, because it's generated on the power supply board, whereas the other 8.5 volt for the VCO is generated inside the VCO with a separate voltage stabilizer. But that's not the problem. This pot here is connected to 8.5 volt, and the output, the wiper here, is fed via the switch, that's the RID switch, and the contact of the relay, it's the RX-TX relay in position RX, it's fed to pin A, and this pin A is the same as we have seen before. This is the input here. So we would expect, in case of centered pot, RID pot, the same voltage as we have when it comes when the RID is switched off or on, we always should have the same voltage in the center position of this pot to have no frequency variation. But this is not possible. Here we have a design flaw. This pot here is grounded on the other side. This is the plus E 8.5. And here we have the trim pot 1K to ground. So we should adjust this wiper, the center of the wiper, to the required voltage with the trim pot to ground. But this is not possible, and I will show you why. And here we have the problem. This is a VCO with the internal voltage of 3.85 volt. We have measured 3.9 volt. Okay, no problem. But the center voltage here is 4.25 volt because we have 8.5 volt, the RID pot on the front. And even in the case that this trim pot for the RID is set to 0 ohm, we have here a voltage divider, 8.5 volt divided by 2. When we have in the center position here, the wiper, then we have an output of 4.25 volt. but here we have 3.85 volt. And when we close the red switch and connect the wiper to the VCO, we have a voltage jump here. 4.52 volt is connected to 3.85, and the voltage, the result, is anywhere in between, but it is not correct, and we cannot simply adjust this center position of the wiper down to 3.85 volt because less than 0 ohm is not possible here. So this trim pot should be there, or there's another solution, but so it does not work, and I'll show you the voltages. We have here the voltage at the input of the VCO. It's again this position. Here, pin A. We have the 3.9 before red is open. The red pot is centered, and when I switch on the red, the voltage increases to 4.25 volt. Why? Because the internal resistance of the pot with only 500 ohms. This here has a source impedance of 250 ohms, and there is also 250, it's 125 ohms. And here we have a source impedance of 20k approximately. So this voltage overrides this voltage here, and the 4.25 volt are now present. Of course, I can adjust it with the red pot down to zero. I think zero voltage is a little bit dangerous for the VCO. And I can go up to 8.5 volt. So there is a rather big variation. But the center position, again, is not correct. That's a problem of the red circuit. It cannot be solved by alignment. It's a design flaw. There is maybe a solution. I will think about it. I will have some contact with the owner. The possible solution could be like this. I don't want to be much more clever than the guys who designed this transceiver, but I think there's a design flaw. The 47K and 39K are wrong. They should be vice versa. 39 and 47. So the voltage here would be theoretically 4.65 volt. And this is a little bit more than 4.25 volt. And then we can adjust it or increase this voltage on the wiper with this resistor, with this trimmer, up to 4.65. This would be the right design, I think. And then also it is not possible to go down with a wiper to 0 volt, because the VCO, I think, wouldn't accept 0 volt. It's not so good. This is my personal opinion, but I'm quite sure that this is not correct. Should have been like this. Whether I will change it, I will check the behavior of the VCO, and then I will talk to the owner what to do or not to do. Maybe I will check it first with my own SE400, because I have the SE400 and I had the same problem with the RID, but up to now I didn't modify or repair it. It was not a big problem for me, but on the other hand, it's not nice to have such a problem and a trim pot which is useless. So I will try it with my own transceiver, and then we can continue or not, depending upon what the owner says. It shouldn't be so difficult to change these two resistors. I think it is rather good accessible. There is a box, shielded box. I will look at it, how easy it is to get access to it. Okay, that's a rich problem. It can be solved, and maybe it will be solved in any way. And now we are at the end of part two of the series about the Braun SE402 transceiver. Stay tuned, stay healthy, see you on this channel.